Hello, my lovely anatomists and physiologists. Michele Glass here, and welcome to chapter three. Chapter three is all about the cell. So we first started looking at cells. Well, Robert Hooke first started looking at cells in 1665, and he looked at little tiny shavings of cork. So basically dead plant cells, and they just look like little rooms, and they were named cells, like a little room in a monastery. And about 10 years later, Antony von Leeuwenhoek gets on the scene, and he is so curious, and his microscopes are so much better that he just starts looking at all sorts under the microscope, and our knowledge of cells just has really grown from there. In chapter three, we're looking at the generic generalized cell. So this is an example of cell type that's found really in plants, fungi, and animals, which of course means humans. And when we talk about the cell, remember this is the smallest living unit of life. And so everything that our body is doing, it's functioning at the cellular level. And so we're going to take this like basic generic information that we learned in chapter three and then begin to apply it to specialized cells as we get into different body systems. So there's a lot. We could just spend years studying the cell. So buckle up, get ready, take breaks when you need to, and let's start with the cell membrane. All right, y'all, when we are talking about this cell membrane, what we are really talking about is the outermost border to the cell, the outermost border of the cell. And it's the job of the cell membrane to really, you know, be like that club bouncer, to really regulate what enters or exits the cell, but it regulates what enters or exits the cell. And it's really making the inside of the cell special and unique versus the outside of the cell. So it's really helping to kind of provide a separate internal, let's just say environment. When we talk about the inside of the cell, we will talk about it as being full of a fluid, and we call the inner fluid the intracellular fluid. Intra means within, and we can then abbreviate this as the ICF. So intracellular fluid can be abbreviated as ICF. So that's why I like to use that particular description. When we talk about the inside fluid being the intracellular fluid, then we can talk about the outside fluid as being the extracellular fluid. And here we can abbreviate extracellular fluid as the ECF. So very often we'll see that prefix extra as indicating outside of, in addition to the cell. When we discuss the cell membrane, we will sometimes see it described as the plasma membrane. Or you might even see it called the plasma lemma. So these are all possible names for this structure. I tend to call this structure cell membrane, but from time to time, I do try to use these other terms so you can become familiar. When we talk about the structure of the cell membrane, that's when we can use this description, phospholipid bilayer, phospholipid bilayer, where the phospholipid is talking about a certain type of molecule, the phospholipid molecule. And we were introduced to the phospholipid molecule in chapter two. So if you remember, our phospholipid molecule has was described as a hydrophilic head. This is the phosphate group. So the hydrophilic head loves water. Remember, water loving. And then we have what's called the hydrophobic tail, and that's the lipid part. So the top portion of the molecule loves water, it's polar, and the bottom portion of the molecule hates water, it's nonpolar because it's a lipid. Now, phospholipid bilayer indicates two layers. So what we'll see is you have a whole bunch of these phospholipid molecules together in a row, side by side. That's one layer. And then you're going to draw a second layer, but notice you're going to position it so that the tails of each layer is pointed in towards each other, and the heads of each molecule are pointed on the outside, such that those phospholipid heads are either pointing in the direction of the extracellular fluid, the fluid outside of the cell, or positioned towards the intracellular fluid, which is the fluid on the inside of the cell, right? And so this is the bilayer. Now, what is significant here is we then are creating a nonpolar zone, or we can say a lipid layer, where you have those fatty acid hydrophobic tails pointing in towards each other. And so this creates what we can describe as a selectively permeable barrier. Selectively permeable barrier, where again, the cell membrane is functioning kind of like the bouncer. Right? It's determining what gets in and what gets out of the cell. And it's doing that in large part because of this lipid layer, because of these hydrophobic tails pointing in towards each other. Now, what we'll see is that this phospholipid bilayer is fluid. The phospholipid bilayer is fluid. Think of like an oil. So there's a lot of give and take in it. So there's a lot of movement that we see with the phospholipid bilayer of the cell membrane. Now, depending on the conditions for the organism, meaning whether you live in like a really cold place or really warm place, we'll see that your cells, and when I say really cold, really warm, we probably see these differences more in like Arctic fishes versus not Arctic fishes. What we'll see embedded in the lipid layer is a molecule called cholesterol. And cholesterol is like four rings. So I'm gonna kind of draw it like this. It's not like a great cholesterol drawing, but I think it's fine for what we're doing. And so what we'll see is that the cholesterol molecule is a lipid, and it's going to help stabilize the phospholipid bilayer. So the phospholipids themselves are giving us that selective permeability, but it's fluid. It's oil. It's oily, right? It's too fluid. We need some structure. We need some structure. And so cholesterol is going to provide that structure. So it's going to help stabilize. It's going to help stabilize that fluid mosaic model. Okay, we also are going to see proteins as part of our membrane. So we're going to have let's give them another color. We're going to have proteins. sense. We're going to have some proteins that are like inside. And then we have some proteins that are like on the outside. Okay. So we see that the phospholipid is a lipid. We see the cholesterol is a lipid. So lipids are clearly important in cell membrane structure. But then we also have membrane proteins. And we have two types here. We have what we can call integral. And we have what we can call peripheral. So when we look at our membrane proteins, we can have integral. So the membrane protein that I drew that was kind of like embedded all the way through that phospholipid bilayer would be integral. So we can talk about them as being embedded. Now your integral, your embedded proteins can serve as protein channels, which we can think of as like selective doorways. Channels and opening. We're going to see that these can also act as receptors. And receptors then are going to bind to specific molecules. And then we can talk about the channel and the receptor proteins as being involved then in communication. So we can remember that as we move forward. We'll also see some integral proteins that are involved as cell recognition. Oops. So our cells can recognize each other. They can recognize which cells belong in our body and which don't. They can recognize each other in terms of, you know, if they need to work together in some way, right? So cell recognition is going to be an important piece of these integral membrane proteins. Here, we're going to think about a molecule specifically called a glycoprotein. When we talk about cell recognition. The glyco here means like carbohydrate. So glycoprotein is a molecule that has carbohydrate paired with a protein, okay? When we talk about peripheral membrane proteins, think about these as like post-it notes. So it's something that's like stuck on the outside of the cell membrane and just like you can stick it on, you can rip it off, right? So you can like take it on and off, right? So that would be like your peripheral proteins. So I'm going to write post-it note here as just like an example. And the peripheral proteins will have specific functions. So they can vary based on what the cell needs and what the protein is. You can see them stuck to either the inner or the outer surface. And so again, depending on whether it's an internal peripheral or an external peripheral protein, it might have different kind of job. We'll see very often that these can act as digestive enzymes. Remember, enzymes are a special type of protein that are important in helping to catalyze chemical reactions. So a digestive enzyme is going to be involved in hydrolysis or breakdown reactions, things we talked about in chapter two. And then you can also see them involved in just further catalysis or catabolism breakdown of like nutrients, catalyzed nutrients. So we'll see these different examples here of membrane proteins. Okay. Now, when we talk about the phospholipid bilayer, we saw that it's composed of the lipids. So we have the phospholipid molecule as like the bulk of the molecule really involved in selective permeability. We have the cholesterol lipid, which is helping to stabilize the fluid nature of the phospholipid bilayer. We have membrane proteins that are either integrated or embedded all the way through the membrane, or peripheral, which are like post-it notes stuck to either the inner surface or the outer surface. We mentioned the glycoprotein as being like a carbohydrate and protein combination. So we will see carbohydrates as important in membrane structure as well. So we're going to have proteins, lipids, and carbohydrates, all three involved in membrane structure. So let's talk for just a minute about what's referred to as the glycocalyx. The glycocalyx is going to be where we see really those carbohydrates. And it's usually carbohydrate plus either a protein or a lipid. So we're going to have glycoproteins and glycolipids, part of the glycocalyx, right? And what we see is that these are really going to be coating the cell. So this glycocalyx is on the outer surface of the cell membrane, coating the cell. And the glycocalyx then is going to be important in helping cells bind to other cells. So the glycocalyx can help cells bind to other cells to form tissues. They can be important again as enzymes to catalyze nutrients. The same function we saw with the peripheral proteins, because remember the glycocalyx involves peripheral proteins. And we can also see this involved in that cell recognition. This is part of the cell's identity. So again, recognition. So this will be important as cells communicate to each other. This is important as the body identifies which cells belong and which cells don't belong. So again, glycocalyx, remember, is where we really see those carbohydrates, and the carbohydrates are not by themselves. They're paired with proteins, glycoproteins, or they're paired with lipids, glycolipids, and they have all of these sort of functions together. Okay, up next is a discussion of, if the membrane is selectively permeable, what does that mean? So we're looking at transport next. So stay tuned. And as always, take care of yourselves and each other.